Today, we're going to do a countdown of the best office productivity tips of 2013. We do a lot of webinars throughout the year, and these are what we think are the best. If you disagree, then share away. Go ahead and type your favorite tips into the IM window, or if you're on the blog, go ahead and type a comment. So let's start with number 10, which is how to pick up where you left off in Word. I'm going to open up a document that I've had, and that's this Northwind proposal document here. I'm logged in to my Office 365 account, and Word knows that, and it says, okay, where were you last working? And it gives me that marker right over here, okay? It says, welcome back. Pick up where you left off at the Northwind Sales Analysis section, okay? Incidentally, that was 44 minutes ago. So I'll go ahead and click that marker, and I'll jump right to that point in the document in which I was editing. And if you take this further, you can press Shift F5, and it'll jump your cursor right to the very place in which you last edited, which is pretty great. Now I'm just going to make some arbitrary edits here just to demonstrate a point, and that is you can do Shift F5 again, and you can repeatedly bounce back to the last places you edited, the last three places, okay? So here I edited that number, I edited this one, I'm going sort of back in time here. Got it? So that's Shift F5. Go back to the last thing you edited. And in this example, it doesn't pack as much punch, but if you were making like three previous edits on three different pages, it's a real eye strain saver, okay? So you don't have to scroll and see all the content flying by your eyes. You can just press Shift F5 and it'll bounce for you to your previous edits. Let's go to tip number 9, Excel surveys in the cloud. Now, Excel surveys have been in cloud service for a while, okay? I'm going to go up here to create and choose Excel survey. And by the way, I've signed in with my free Microsoft account, and Excel surveys are free. You don't have to pay for this, okay? I'm here in a modern browser, you know, and I can type a title for my survey. Let's say this is the holiday dessert survey. Okay, and I can enter my first question here. Maybe I'm polling my friends or family for what they want to eat at a holiday dinner. So my first question will be, what kind of pie do you like? Okay, I'm going to do a multiple choice question for that. And then go ahead and type in the choices here. Now, you know, of course, you could do a more business appropriate example, but it's also good for family and personal stuff. Let's see, pumpkin and vanilla cream, maybe. Done. New question. It's real easy. It's fast, too. Question, what kind of topping do you like? People might have some very verbose answers to that one. I myself like whipped cream and Cool Whip, so I might want to, you know, explain and expound on that answer there, so I'll give my users that option as well. And then I'll click Done, and then add a new question. And how many pieces of pie do you want? Choose a number. Okay, done. Save and view. Okay, and now this is what my friends and family will see when I share this survey with them, okay? What kind of pie do you like? I like pumpkin. What kind of topping? Whipped cream and Cool Whip combo. And how many pieces of pie? I want 2. And I submit. Okay? It's real easy. I mean, you could do this for a variety of purposes. You might even do it for your own kind of online invitation if you wanted to. So here we go. We click Close. And where's that data stored once it's submitted? Right here in the cloud, on this online spreadsheet here, okay? Pretty amazing stuff. Now you can use your Excel data analysis tools to work with this data. Perhaps you want to insert a pie chart. You just might want to. Okay, tip number 8, how to use Outline View in PowerPoint. Now, Outline View is an old tried and true feature. It's been in PowerPoint for a while, but we demonstrated this for people and it really resonated with them. So we might as well show you again. Outline view is on the View tab, and it's great when you are staring a blank PowerPoint presentation in the face and you don't know where to begin. You can use this left-hand outline pane over here to outline yourself, outline your presentation. So I'll make the first slide here, Welcome, and maybe make the second slide here, Agenda, and then the third slide here could be maybe Conclusions. Okay, and now I have those three slides automatically created for my presentation. And you can take it a step further if you press return and then demote your bullet level. You can now enter bullets for the slides. So maybe your first bullet on the agenda slide is, oh, what's working with this project? Another agenda item might be what's not working. And then maybe a solutions agenda item. Okay, so this is outline view. Take it a step further, copy your bullet items, paste them, and then promote them. And now you have slides for each of those agenda items. What's working with this project, what's not working, and solutions. Okay, that's outline view. What's another view in PowerPoint that's awesome? Well, that's presentation view. And that's tip number 7 in our top 10 countdown here. So let's check that out. We'll go to slideshow and make sure we've got use presenter view selected here. And then we'll start our slideshow. Let me switch to presenter view here. Here it is. The slide that you're on, the current slide, shows up here in this big pane here that says welcome. And this is, incidentally, all your users would see if you were in a conference room projecting to a screen. But the presenter view here is a special view for your laptop when you're at a podium or whatnot. So here's your current slide. Here's the next slide to show you what's coming up so you can prepare for that mentally. And then if you had notes, they would appear down here in the lower right, okay? And then, of course, you've got your navigational items down here so you could advance to other slides if you needed to. And you've got some inking tools here. You've got a timer that shows you how long you're taking with your presentation. This is all really great stuff, and this is really helpful for those big presentations and conference rooms. So check it out, presenter view. You get to that by making sure this checkbox is selected on the slideshow tab. Okay. Tip number 6, we're going to switch on over to OneNote, and we're going to show you how to put your page tabs on the left. Now, one of the things that people have sort of a difficulty with OneNote is they're not sure how things are stored. They're not sure what the basic building blocks are. So let's go over those real quickly, and then this tip will make more sense. Over here on the left, you've got notebooks. Those are the largest containers in OneNote, if you will, okay? Inside a notebook are your sections. And people also call sections tabs. Those are just interchangeable terms. Tabs, sections, same thing. Inside your tabs are your pages, okay? These are pages. Notebooks contain sections, and sections contain pages. Now, sometimes people forget that there are pages, and they create a bunch of sections, or they create one really big, long page, and they don't realize that they can divide them up. So one good thing to do is to move these page tabs over to the left, okay? And the way you do that is you go to File, Options, Display, and then Page Tabs appear on the left. We'll click OK. And it's really helpful because now all your basic building blocks in OneNote are sort of snug together here. You've got your notebook, your section, and your pages. So now you can easily navigate all those different building blocks really easily. Okay. So that's how to put your page tabs on the left in OneNote. Okay. Tip number 5, how to use version history in Office web apps. So check that out. We'll go back over here to our cloud storage. And we'll go ahead and open up a file here that we did a couple weeks ago in another webinar. Okay, this was a t-shirt sign-up worksheet that we made. But if I wanted to go back in time and see earlier versions, I go to File, and I go to info and then previous versions. Okay. On the left, you'll see a list of older versions. Okay. And you can go back in time, so to speak. I'm going to go to the very first one here. And you can see I have barely anything filled out there. Just that's because that's the first version. I wasn't quite done with it yet. But if you wanted to, you could restore this version so that it's the current version, or you could download this particular version and work with it if you needed to. Okay. Another way to do this is if you go back to your cloud storage and you right-click a file and choose version history. That's another way to get to that same place. Okay. That's version history in the Office web apps, and that's in the Word, Excel, and PowerPoint web app. Tip number four is how to use keyboard shortcuts on Outlook.com. Let's head on over there. We'll switch on over to Outlook.com because we're signed in here. Okay. If you don't have an Outlook.com account, I highly recommend it. This email service is beautiful and clean and easy to use. And if you have a Hotmail account, it works the same way. It'll look just like this. Okay. One of the things that I really love about it are the keyboard shortcuts. And it's kind of unusual because you think keyboard shortcuts, this isn't a web browser. I can't do that. Well, sure you can. There are special keyboard shortcuts. If you press shift question mark, you can see a list of all the keyboard shortcuts that are available on Outlook.com. Isn't that amazing? Look at all these. N for new mail. Alt S to send. R to reply. Okay. Check spelling is F7. Mark email as junk. How many times does that happen a day? For me, it happens a lot. I sign up for a lot of gift lists and things, and then I need to get rid of them when I'm tired of them. So J is a good one, okay? And look at this. If you go down here to this little sneaky link here that says go to settings, okay, you can change the keyboard shortcuts scheme to match another email service like Yahoo or Gmail, okay? I'm going to stick with Outlook.com because I've always had an Outlook.com account. So I'm going to stay there. I'll go back to Outlook, and let me just show you how some of these work. I'm going to press the N key, and I get a new message. I can use the arrow down to a contact and press Enter. Okay, haven't even touched the mouse yet. Press Tab, and I can type a subject. Okay, press Tab, and I can type a message. Okay, pretty handy. Alt S sends it away. Okay, here's the J key. I could press J on this email from Doug Thomas and mark it as junk. I'm not going to do that. He's a coworker of mine. So anyway, that's keyboard shortcuts in Outlook, and I really love that feature. So check that out when you have a chance. Tip number three is the news feed in SharePoint 2013. I've logged into my fictitious Officer 65 account here for Robin Counts, and I'm on the news feed for her, okay? If your plan of Office 365 for Business includes the news feed, I highly recommend it. You can share little microblog posts like Twitter or Facebook, right? And you can say, you know, report status on certain things, or ask questions of people in your organization. And for example, I could say, I just finished the Contoso presentation. Thanks to, and then you could type the at key, and you can tag people like Pavel, for example, post, and then other people that are following you can see that. Tip number two is the Surface and Surface 2. Two great devices, and currently the Surface is $350. The Surface 2 is $450. Why are they great? They include Office RT, Office 2013 RT, which includes Word, Excel, PowerPoint, OneNote, and Outlook. You now get Outlook on that device, okay? Especially if you get the Windows 8.1 update. So check those out. Those are great values and great gifts for the holiday season. And then finally, tip number one is my favorite thing by far, Flash Fill in Excel. If you haven't used this thing, check it out. I'm going to also show you a real easy way to use it if you're having a hard time triggering it, okay? Let's say you need to strip out these codes over here, okay, out of this column into this one. How do you do that? Well, in Excel 2013, just start typing. CR1302, enter, and do the second one, SA, and then boom, there you go. You've got that flash fill auto suggestion there that's sort of faded. And if you like those suggestions, press enter, and you got those codes stripped out into their own clean column there. Now, sometimes people have a hard time triggering that. So if that's the case, just select your cells, have that first one filled out, and then go up to fill and choose flash fill from the home tab, okay? And then that'll trigger it for you. That about rounds out our top 10 tips of 2013. If you have a favorite tip, go ahead and type it in. We want to know about it. And for more information about our general webinar series, go to aka.ms/offweb for calendar and a downloadable Outlook reminder. Come back next week because Doug's going to talk about cool tools for your computer. Thanks very much to Doug, Bruce, and Chris today. We had a small webinar team, but we knocked it out good as usual. Stick around for the Q&A, and thanks very much for joining us.